Hello, I'm Dr. John Perlin, Chief Medical Officer and President of Clinical Services at HCA Healthcare. Welcome to A Physician's Lens, a series of periodic conversations with our physician and clinical community on topics of general clinical interest and interest to the HCA Healthcare family. Joined today by Dr. Edmund Jackson, our Chief Data Scientist and Chief Data Officer, and our topic today is data science, particularly as it's applied to COVID. Mm-hmm. So, Edmund Jackson, as we say in the South, you're not from around here. Quick introduction on your background.
Well, thank you, Dr. Perlin. Yes, you can tell from my accent I'm from further south, very, very far south, South Africa, in fact. I like to joke that I'm more southern than all of you all put together. But anyway, it's a delight to be here. Thank you for the opportunity to talk about data and analytics and data science.
So you carry two titles, mm-hmm. Chief Data Officer and Chief Data Scientist. Mm-hmm. What does this mean? What do you do?
So the two relate to data. Chief Data Officer relates to creating the foundations of data that are necessary for appropriate and high-end analytics. And Chief Data Scientist is to lead those analysts, data scientists, who are using the data to create output. So it's really to put the two things together, to create good data and then to use it well.
One of the blessings, the privileges of scale is the ability to, as we say, learn at speed. We've created a learning health system out of our information architecture, which means that every piece of data that's created in the act of clinical care is collected into a data warehouse that can be channeled back for improving quality. One of the best examples of that is one that we've worked together a good bit on, that's SPOT, sepsis prediction and optimization of therapy. In the aggregate, it saved 8,000 lives. And a particular congratulations, Edmund, SPOT just recently was recognized with the John M. Eisenberg Award, Quality Award for
Huge
Innovation.
Honor. Well, thank you, Dr. Perlin. That project is the reason I joined HCA. It's the reason I stay at HCA. And, you know, I want to thank you for the leadership behind that for year after year to back it up.
And both of us really thank our clinical colleagues for making this work. And what's really gratifying to us is that for those of us who hunted and pecked through the electronic health record, we've heard back that it's not the routine decision support, but things like SPOT, quote unquote, that make using the electronic health record worthwhile. Mm-hmm. One of the things you've stressed, Edmund, is that SPOT is not just a program for sepsis, but it demonstrates a platform, and you've been working on another platform called NATE. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about NATE, and then let's dovetail into how that applies to our care of patients with coronavirus.
Sure. So NATE is the son of SPOT. In order to create SPOT, we had to create a data platform with our IT colleagues that spanned the entire nation and brought all of our data together, made it usable and accessible in real time. And so once we worked on SPOT for a while, the question then became, what next? And so we've created a platform, NATE, that's very plastic, configurable, and usable by any user to create different sorts of real-time products. And there's been a Cambrian explosion in the number of things that are now available on NATE. So in particular, I think we could talk about the coronate, because that's top of mind right now.
Yeah, a really bad pun. Coronate, get it?
I can't help myself. I'm a father of two, and I like a dad joke. So coronate is a platform that spans all of our facilities and gives real-time information on the COVID population. Specifically, in the early days, it was around who were persons of interest, who had a positive test. Now it's who's recovered, where are they, when were the labs taken, the full picture at a hospital level rolling all the way up. And it's available to any member of the HCA community.
So I personally got a copy of that on my smartphone, and it's really terrific, but it allows you to see how patients are cohorted, what the patient load is. Mm-hmm. And where do you see that going?
Everywhere. Everywhere. So the idea is that it's a platform on which multiple products can be built. And after Coronate, we've already started working on a product with case management called Tempo. And that's an idea, a vision, a product that came out of the Central West Texas division, tremendous leadership there. And we've been able to work with them now to scale it across the entire nation. And it allows for very, very rapid barrier rounds. We're now talking about safety rounds. We're talking about throughput optimization, and the sky's the limit.
Yeah, well, this is really exciting. If SPOT is directly at clinical care, then NATE and Coronate helps us manage patient throughput. Mm-hmm. And obviously tremendously important in the era of COVID, as we want to cohort patients with COVID, knowing that positive means positive, negative, not necessarily that, but to the extent that we know those COVID patients, we want to isolate them because that gives us the opportunity to really resume business. We know that so many of our physician and clinical colleagues have been struggling during this period of less normal activity. It's really quite remarkable. Mm-hmm. But our ability to load balance allows us not only to care responsibly for COVID patients, but to care responsibly for all patients, and that's pretty exciting. One of the things that we hope we're not excited by is that we hope the activity is quiescent across the summer. Some of us are worried about recrudescence in the fall. Edmund, you've been doing a lot of work on COVID projections. Talk a little bit about your work on COVID projections, and let's dovetail to some of the work on community COVID projections.
Well, absolutely. Well, thank you, sir. The projection of COVID was probably the hardest thing I've ever tried to do, and failed pretty hard at it as well. So in the early days, we were dealing with something we'd never seen before, and there was no data. And so we only had theory to rely upon. It turned out that theory was perhaps, you know, a little bit aggressive in its approach. And it was a wonderful example of HCA coming together. Because, you know, I created some projections, and very quickly the feedback came, these are not realistic. We're not seeing that in our hospitals. And so very rapidly, given the privilege of our scale, we were able to bind that with real data and come up with what we call the San Jose model, because we were experiencing the COVID primarily on the coasts in the beginning. And San Jose was one of the first facilities to actually experience it. And we were able to take the experience there, generalize it, and apply it to all of the facilities. And it gave us a really solid foundation, a really realistic perspective of the timing, the scope, and the magnitude of the outbreak. That's really internally focused. And we were really thinking about the resource constraints, which are, as we all know, the ICU beds and the ventilators. And that was the population that we were projecting. As the world has caught up with COVID, there have been a tremendous number of external models built, and I really have to call out the IHME model, which has been extremely accurate. The concern now is as we loosen social distancing, as policies start to change, some of the models, and the IHME is one, are predicting a small resurgence in some areas with high population density. So the new models take into account mobility as measured by people's movement with their cell phones, population density, global connectedness, I mean the travel between cities and so forth. And so we run some risk.
Well, what I think is so important about the work that you're doing is that you're bringing it down to the scale of our HCA markets. Because a picture of what's going on across the United States isn't a picture of what's going on in Nashville or Dallas or Miami, Florida. Frankly, a picture of Nashville is not what's going on across all of Tennessee. Yeah. And your ability to really tailor those models to our specific markets really helps us operationally make sure that we have the supplies, the PPE that's necessary, and move about resources if there are areas that are at risk of a recrudescence. This is really spectacular work, Edmund.
Thank you.
Let me thank you for your leadership on that. It's I think, the fulmination of a learning health system, that concept I mentioned before, where the data created through every encounter go into a collective memory that helps us improve the system and improve patient care with every touch. And we know that each of you, our clinical community members, are that patient touch, and this is a challenging time. We wish you the best, and on behalf of Dr. Edmund Jackson and myself, we certainly thank you for all that you're doing.